removes and he prunes every branch that produces fruit so that it will produce more fruit. You already are clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me and I in you. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains on the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit, because you can do nothing without me. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and he withers. They gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit and be my disciples, and prove to be my disciples. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we have a promise in Christ of eternal life. And we thank you, Father, for that promise that's in Christ and in him alone, and that no man will come to you unless it's through you, our Savior Jesus. I just pray that you would guide my words this morning, Lord, that I wouldn't speak anything out of a vain or arrogant heart, but humbly present your word as you've given it to me to prepare this morning. Thank you for everyone here. Thank you for the hearers and the doers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So my sermon text, as you heard this morning, is out of John. And it hasn't lost anything in 2,000 years. It shouldn't have lost anything in 2,000 years. And as Hank was talking about this morning, we don't know the coming of the Lord. We don't know when it will be. And it says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, let us hold on to the confession of our hope, that hope that he's coming. Let us hold on to it without wavering, since he who promised is faithful. Jesus is faithful. He is a faithful friend. He will come again, because he said, I will come back in like manner as you have seen me ascend. He told his disciples as they were standing there on the Mount of Olives. And he says, and let us watch out for one another to provoke love and good works, not neglecting to gather together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching. The day referenced in this verse is, of course, the coming of our Lord Jesus. We as his church, his body in the world, should be in fact bolder today, stronger today, and provoking one another to walk like he walked, to be strong disciples, more so than ever before. The writer of Hebrews says that it was a habit for people not to get together back then. We see it happening still today. It's a habit where people say, I don't need to go, but we do need to. We need each other. We have to depend upon each other. We have to get close to each other. We are his body. We need each other.
Amen.
It says that we should be more motivated together as his disciples as we see his return getting closer. We don't know the day or the hour. We don't know when he's coming. But we all can look around and we can see what's going on in the world today. We look at the culture. We watch the news. And even use some common sense that he gave us to see that we are racing towards a time and a place that he will return. And we cannot walk through any of these things that are coming on this earth unless we are rooted in him, our true vine. So let's go to the scripture that we were reading this morning, and we're going to work through them one verse at a time, maybe two at a time. Verses one, gardener, but it's interchangeable. The vine that Jesus is most likely using as a reference is a grapevine. And I don't know if many of you have been around a lot of grapevines, but they can be rough sometimes. It takes a while to get established. But an established grapevine has strong, sturdy trunks like a small tree and strong, thick branches that support the smaller, thin branches. The nourishment to the small branches of the vine come directly from the thick, sturdy trunk, just like a tree produces the small branches. It's the sustenance of the tree. The sustenance of the vine comes from the trunk. This word picture that Jesus is using describes these little branches are us. We're these little bitty branches on this vine or the tree. We cannot sustain by ourselves. We have to have that trunk that sucks the water and the nutrients from the ground. Jesus is that trunk for us. God the Father is pictured as the gardener or vine dresser who comes through and he prunes the dead, worthless branches from the main branch so the vine will be healthy and that it will produce fruit. All through this chapter, Christ calls us to bear fruit, and he gives us instruction on how to do so. And church, it's all by faith. We can only produce fruit by faith in him and Christ alone. The Father comes and he prunes us because sometimes we're not bearing enough fruit. And pruning doesn't feel good. It's humiliating. But he loves us and he wants us to love him. Those that aren't producing are removed and cast into the fire, as it says. But we'll get back to that in a little bit. In 2014, I, of course, was minding my own business, doing my work as a law enforcement officer. And God started stirring in my heart. Actually, probably 2012, 2013, he really started working in my heart, my life. And he called me to go to Israel as an ambassador for himself, the ambassador of Jesus, to help Jewish farmers in the hill country of Judea and Samaria. I took my oldest son with me, and we were vine dressers on the mountains. They taught us how to do it. We served, and we tried to be lights to our Israeli hosts. Our main job was to dress these vines. We learned which branches were being supported by the main vine and needed to be pruned, and which branches were not good at all and needed to be cut off. It was a humbling experience. We spent hundreds of hours on those mountains, pruning vines. And God revealed to me in my heart at that time what a proud, arrogant man I really was. I've always been a strong man. I've always had strength in my hands. And within 3 weeks, my hands gave out. And they went numb. And I had pain, overwhelming. And I felt useless. But that's what God was trying to show me. That I was useless without being tapped into that vine, to that main branch. And he gave me this beautiful picture of what we were doing, day in and day out, of how the Father cares for us, and he wants us to bear fruit. So he'll cut things out of us that don't belong, that we don't need to be a spiritual man or a spiritual woman. What a wonderful picture he gave to me in those months that I was there. Moving on to verse 3, he says, "You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you." At first glance, when I was reading through this, I thought, this is a strange verse to be put in the middle of a pruning chapter. This verse just kind of stuck out. But, you know, John knew what he was doing when he put it in there. He recalled correctly that Jesus said to his disciples the day that they prepared for the Last Supper, that you are already clean, he said to them. And it's a reference out of John 13. And he says, Peter said to him, as Jesus prepared to wash their feet, "You will not wash my feet." Jesus told him, "If I don't wash you, you have no part with me." And Simon, of course, said, "Lord, not only my feet, but all of me. My hands and my head also. But Jesus came back and said, "One who is bathed, one who has been baptized doesn't need to wash anything except his feet, but he is completely clean. You are clean, but not all of you." Jesus explained to Peter here that the foot washing was necessary. And Peter, being Peter, we know how Peter is, says, okay, then don't stop with my feet. But Jesus was emphatic that a person who's already been baptized, who has already had a transformed heart, who's already been converted, doesn't have to be baptized and washed again and again, but he only needs to do a foot washing every once in a while. Today, as we take the Lord's Supper, this is kind of our foot washing in a sense. It's a remembrance of him. It says, do this for remembrance of me. This scripture came out of John 13. It's a scripture that says you need to be cleaned, but not all of you, not again, if you are already a believer, if you've already got a transformed heart, if he's already brought you into his fold, you merely need to take this bread and this wine to remember him so that he can cleanse you. Verse 4 says, remain in me, and I in you. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains on the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. It is a fact that we cannot do anything apart from God. Fruit produced outside of God is nothing but a dead work. Many people have done marvelous good deeds, and there's nothing wrong with doing good deeds. Nothing at all. But anything that's done outside of the will of Christ or outside of Christ will die with that person. The fruit that is produced in you as a follower of Jesus will last an eternity. The lives that we have now are only temporary. We have an eternity with Christ. We have an eternity. We'll see the fruits that we've produced one day in the kingdom of heaven. Hallelujah. Fruits of righteousness are through Christ and by his empowerment, by his Holy Spirit. All works will die with those who did them unless they are done in and through the true vine, which is Christ the Lord. Verse 5 says, I am the vine, and you are the branches. The one who remains in me, and I in him, produces much fruit, because you can do nothing without me. We cannot produce spiritual fruit or remain without Jesus. Without him, we are helpless and we're lost. But with him and through him, we can move mountains. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, as it says in Philippians 4:13. How else could a small band of men who followed Jesus around change the world like they did? Christianity is all throughout the earth these days. It's not just in Jerusalem. It's not just in Israel. It's throughout the whole earth. Because these men were obedient, they went out and they changed the world through their preaching and through their teaching and through their light that they shined. Great works were done through them. Great works can be done through you, through Christ. So we need to trust in him and his working in us. Sometimes we can't see the things that we're doing with our physical eyes, but much more things happen in the heavenly realm, in the spiritual realm, that we aren't even aware of because we are stuck in these bodies. God has given us an ability to do things in the heavenlies through him and through his power that we are not even aware of. So when we produce fruit, we're doing things that cause earthquakes to the demons. They don't like it when we're praising God, when we're singing songs of joy to the Lord our God. They hate it. So when you sing with your might. Praise the Lord with your whole heart. Rejoice evermore because you are stirring up things that you cannot see in the heavenlies. The angels are around his throne day and night, it says in the book of Revelation, praising him and giving glory to God. So should we in our everyday lives, every minute of our lives, if we can think about it. In Sunday school this morning, Jack said, do we think about the Holy Spirit all the time? Is he always there talking to us? Do we talk back? Not always, do we? We forget. We get busy. We get doing life. But he's always there. He's always reminding us. Bear fruit in me. I am there with you. You cannot do anything alone. It says, for although we live in the flesh, we do not wage war according to the flesh, since the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but are powerful through God for the demolition of strongholds. We demolish arguments and every proud thing that is raised up against the knowledge of God, and we take every thought captive to obey Christ. It says in 1 Corinthians 10. Isaiah 40, 29 and 31 speaks about our lack of physical abilities to do anything apart from him. It says he gives strength to the faint, and he strengthens the powerless. If you feel powerless today, he will strengthen you. He will strengthen you. Youth, it says, young men may become faint and weary, and young men will stumble and fall. But those who trust in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on the wings of like eagles, and they will run and they will not become weary. They will walk and they will not faint. Praise God for his strength. When you feel weak and when you feel overwhelmed, lean upon the Lord your God for your strength, because he is our strength. He is the true vine. Psalms 121, 1 and 2 says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. So whether you are strong or weak, you cannot do anything without him and apart from him. He is the maker of heaven and earth. He is able to keep us and sustain us in himself, not on our own works or our own strengths, but through him and him alone. On to verse 6, it says, if anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and he withers. What does this mean? What does this mean? It says they gather them and they throw them into the fire and they're burned. When I was pruning vines, we would cut many vines off that were worthless, that they weren't going to produce fruit, they weren't going to be healthy for the vine. We'd throw them and we'd roll them up in piles, and at some point they would get burned. They were useless. They were good for nothing. This verse by itself, if you think about it long enough and hard enough and you think too much into it, could probably offend you. It offended me first time I read it, I think. But let me tell you, church, if you are secure in him and he in you, you don't have to worry about being cut off and thrown to the ground and burned. But if you don't know Jesus, if you don't know him as your Savior, that is the very true thing. That's what's going to happen. He will call those who are not in him and not a part of him. He has given everyone opportunity to come to him and to place their trust in him. There are many scriptures about this. So many that I couldn't even count them, but I put a few down. That when we get to some of these scriptures, like, what does this mean, Lord? What does this mean? Some of you may remember the parable of the wheat and the tares. Jesus says in Matthew 13, the enemy came in, he's giving a parable. The enemy came in and spread weeds among the wheat harvest. And when the workers saw the weeds, they asked the landowner if they should go and pluck them out from amongst the wheat. And he replied, no, unless you pull out some of my wheat by accident. Wait until the harvest, and then you will be able to take up the weeds separately, burn them up, and gather them, my wheat, to my barn. This parable is found in Matthew 13, as I said. It is another example of those who are dispersed amongst the followers of Christ, who are in the church, but who are not of the church. They're not converted. They've come to church, but they're not converted. They sit in the pews, but they refuse to bow their knee to Jesus. I'm calling this scripture hard. It's a harsh scripture, but it comes from the mouth of Jesus. He has no desire that anyone should perish, but that all should come to repentance and come to faith in him. He loves us, dear church. He loves everyone. He loves us so dearly. If you don't know him, please come to him so that you can abide in him. Abide in the vine, the true vine. Verse 7 and 8 says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit and prove to be my disciples. You know, there was a disciple amongst Jesus' disciples. We all know who he is. We don't like saying his name because his name, Judas, is something that stirs up emotion inside of us. It stirs up emotion in me when I think about this man who sat with Jesus, who walked with Jesus, who walked the trails of Israel with Jesus. This man, Judas, who for 30 pieces of silver sold him out. When I think about that, I get angry, I get mad. But you know, he allowed it. He knew what he must do. He knew that he must face many trials. And he won't allow anyone who trusts in him to be thrown out like that. Jesus said, uses the word if in the verses of 7 and 8, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you can ask anything and it will be done for you. Remember, it is by faith that we remain, not by our works. It is by faith that we produce fruit. It is by faith that we ask. When those prayers are answered, our God, Father in heaven, is glorified and not us. When he answers our prayers, he is the one who receives glory, not us. You know, you tell someone, praise God, he answered my prayer. He is the one who receives the glory. He is the one who receives all praise. Sometimes he doesn't answer our prayers the way we think. He doesn't answer our prayers for years to come. I've seen people pray for years about something. We need to pray his will be done. We need to remain in the vine. We need to remain faithful to him. He will remain faithful to us. Because we cannot do anything, church, without being in the true vine. Jesus is our true vine. He's our true vine. Today we're going to partake in the Lord's Supper. I invite everyone who is in the true vine, everyone who is a believer in Jesus today, can participate in this. We do not have a closed communion just for this church. If you are not part of this church, you are welcome as long as you are a believer.
Saved and baptized.
Saved and baptized. By partaking, we are remembering his broken body and the blood that was shed on our behalf. He was our Passover lamb. He was the one that has brought us into the Holy of Holies before the Father. He is the one who reconciles us unto himself. This is not just a ceremony, but a time for transformation in our hearts, a time for cleansing. He has called us to be a holy people in Christ. So as Paul gave the warning to the Corinthian church, not to take this lightly, neither should we. It is for those of us who are saved and baptized, followers of Jesus, and who have followed him in obedience through baptism and are baptized in him and are part of the church, not necessarily just First Baptist. If you're a believer, you can come and take. But if you're not, I'm asking you not to take it. If you have not followed him and become a follower of him, please refrain. Also, if you have some things in your heart that you have against someone, if you've got some sins in your heart that you need to take care of them before you take the supper. Don't just skip it, because this is a foot washing ceremony, folks. This is a cleansing. This is something that he called us to do. This is a commandment. Do in remembrance of me. So I invite everyone to seek your heart, to look inside, to ask the Lord God to reveal anything that you need just to get right with him, to get right with a brother or a sister, to get right before you take the supper this afternoon.
That's a really cool idea.
Thank you for this time that we can do in remembrance of our Savior Jesus. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we ask and we pray these things. And we sang a hymn. He says, as before they left the Mount of Olives, they all sang together. So we're going to sing one last song.
Blessed be the joy.
Well, it was a pretty good service. I suggest come check it out. Y'all have a great day now. And thank you for watching. God bless. And take care.